Ellen White's health message and inspiration. Today, I'm going to talk about several things, Ellen White's health message in general. I'm going to give you an outline of how it came about. I'm going to talk about the accuracy, both in terms of the what's and the whys, which I'll try to define later. But we're going to talk about inspiration. Is that the cause of Ellen White's health message? Is it just chance? Was she just a particularly brilliant woman that was kept down by men and had her the only outlet she could? And then once we've discussed the model, I'm going to apply the model to the Bible and see what happens. And I think that the implications are rather large, and I think they're important. And then, of course, that will all be my opinion, with the supporting evidence, of course. And then it'll be your turn. So, first, outline the message itself. In 1848, we're not sure exactly when, but Ellen White had a vision. It was later dated to 1848. By James White, and the only trace we have of it in her published writings is in Selected Messages, volume 273. And it says, "I have seen in vision that tobacco is a filthy weed and it must be laid aside or given up. Unless it is given up, the frown of God will be upon the one who uses it, and he cannot be sealed with the seal of the living God." This is letter 5 to some particular person. Now, the interesting thing that I found in reading that is that it's very, very short, and it doesn't say anything about health. It says it's filthy, but it doesn't say anything about living longer, better, or anything like that. Just, you ought to give it up. It's also interesting, this is early in her career when she tends to see things as, if you don't do what God expects of you, then you can't be saved. Which is a slightly different perspective from some of her later works. There's another vision in 1854, and here, the record of it is in Selected Messages, volume 3, page 273 through 275, and I won't read the whole thing, but again, it tends to be this is what good people do rather than this is what people who want to maintain their health do. Although you have a hint that maybe it might influence health. I then saw a lack of cleanliness among Sabbath keepers. I saw that God was purifying unto himself a peculiar people. He will have a clean and a holy people in whom he can delight. I saw that the camp must be cleansed, or God would pass by and see the uncleanness of Israel and would not go forth with their armies to battle. So yeah, maybe it does have something to do with health, but it has to do with health because God's going to make sure it does. He would turn from them in displeasure, and our enemies would triumph over us, and we would be left weak in shame and disgrace. I'm contracting the first one into just one line. More from Selected Messages 273 to 275. I saw that God would not acknowledge an untidy, unclean person as a Christian. His frown was upon such. Our souls, bodies, and spirits are to be presented blameless by Jesus to his Father. And unless we are clean in person and pure, we cannot be presented blameless to God. Again, this is all couched in religious terms. And then a little bit later, she talks about food, the appetite and proper food. I then saw that the appetite must be denied, that rich food should not be prepared, and that which is spent upon the appetite should be put in the treasury of God. It would tell there, and those that denied themselves would lay up a reward in heaven. I saw that God was purifying his people. She goes on to talk about rich foods and greasy foods. If you were trying to summarize that, you would say cleanliness and avoiding rich, greasy foods. Well, now, cleanliness is, in fact, a health measure. And, in fact, it was probably more of a health measure in Ellen White's day than it is now. For the simple reason that in Ellen White's day, there were more rats that carried various diseases, including bubonic plague, than there are now. And so it was actually more dangerous to have stuff laying around the house that the rats would rather enjoy. And so here we have no tobacco, cleanliness, avoiding rich, greasy foods, but all kind of in the context of almost like the biblical clean and unclean, where they don't say explicitly, although elsewhere it says, if you do these things, I will put none of the diseases of Egypt on you. But it's the same kind of thing. You're to do this because, kind of almost because I say so, but it's because I say so because it has to do with cleanness, unclean, dirty, filthy. You want to avoid that. And then in 1863, she had her major health vision. And that's one that has all kinds of stuff in it. I'm not going to go into all of the details because there are so many issues, and most of you know most of them anyway. That one is recorded in Spiritual Gifts, Volume 4A, pages 120 to 151. And goes over avoiding the kind of drugs that were being used then, such things as strychnine, calomel, that's mercurous chloride. Nowadays, anybody who puts mercury into their system gets a strange look, and for a good reason. Opium was the other one. Although opium was not condemned in quite the same way as strychnine and calomel were. And then afterwards she wrote a couple of pamphlets that were acknowledged to be a synthesis of what she was hearing from other people and what she had seen in vision. The Spiritual Gifts Volume 4A material is supposed to be, and I think it's arguable that it is, in fact, her own vision without any additions. But that's a long argument to make, and I'm not going to make that at this point. An Appeal to Mothers and How to Live apparently were written after she had read a number of other health reformers. And there were a number, starting with Sylvester Graham, who invented graham crackers. That's a health food. Originally, they were made without sugar, as most of them now are made with sugar. But originally, they were just simply flour and water and a little salt and baked them. And we'll find out that Ellen White ate graham crackers, the original. In 1865, there was another vision that reaffirmed the health message, but also urged the building of a sanitarium for the reason why being that Dr. Jackson's water cure place in Danville, New York, was the best show in town, according to Ellen White. But the problem is that it had a lot of dancing and card playing as part of the recreation, and she felt that both of those were not appropriate, and that there were better ways to pass one's time, including light physical exercise. And she's probably right about that. In 1871, she had another vision, which again confirmed that this was, all of the messages from these, the health points, have already been covered in spiritual gifts. But you can read about the visions themselves if you want to. And this one said it is one branch of the great work that we are doing. And then in 1902, she had, she records being told, as she put it, "I have been instructed that the nut foods are often used unwisely, that too large a proportion of nuts is used, that some nuts are not as wholesome as others. Almonds are preferable to peanuts, but peanuts in limited quantities may be used in connection with grains to make nourishing and digestible food." Which, interestingly enough, has been confirmed. This is the one point where it looks like it is possible that Kellogg may have influenced her. On the other hand, it's possible that she influenced Kellogg in this regard too, since we don't have tape recorders of both of them and what exactly they said to each other. It's very difficult to be sure who influenced who in this regard. And so now we have a vision that says to use nuts in moderation. And finally, in the Ministry of Healing, she reaffirmed the message that she had originally in 1863 and written down in 1864 with very minor changes. As far as her accuracy is concerned, it is rather striking. But it can be divided up into what's and why's. And I'll explain that at this point. What's are what you're supposed to do, or if you want to call them actions, you could. Why's are the reason behind the action, the physiologic justification for doing what you're supposed to do. And in Counsel's Diet and Food, she makes a very clear distinction between the two, at least in regard to salt. She says, "I use some salt and always have, because from the light given me by God, this article, in the place of being deleterious, is actually essential for the blood." Now, there were people who were saying it was deleterious in any amount. She's saying, no, it's necessary, a little bit of it. "The whys and wherefores of this I know not, but I give you the instruction as it is given me." So if you want to shorten whys and wherefores to whys, which I think is fair, that's basically saying this is what you're supposed to do and I'm supposed to do. But I don't really know why. Now, given that, it is very interesting to look at the statistics on Ellen White's health message and inspiration. There are two unverified what's in spiritual gifts. Don McMahon, a physician from Australia, and a health educator, kind of fell into that, went back through Ellen White's material and tried to separate what she recommended for him to do. And she graded it, and he graded her based on the knowledge of the time in which he lived. Well, he's still around, but that was like in 2000, and I think this book is published in 2005 or so. So it's only about 9 years old. There hasn't been much change in the last 9 years in the opinion of the medical community. And of course, this is assuming that the medical community is a gold standard, which we don't really know. But if you make that assumption and you grade Ellen White that way, and it, you know, it's trying to make some kind of a judgment, was she right, was she wrong? There are what he called two unverified what's in spiritual gifts. One of them was the use of leaven should be discouraged, but if you read the four spiritual gifts, page 153, you get, for about 6 months, most of the bread upon our table has been unleavened cakes made of unbolted wheat meal and water and a very little salt. That's graham crackers. So basically, mix the water and the flour and cook it and eat it. Put a little salt in. It doesn't really say there. Well, it goes on to say that she's felt very good after that. So it's kind of, I think it's saying that this is a recommendation for everybody, but it doesn't really say this is what you should do. It just, you know, in our experience, this works. So, I don't know, is that really a recommendation or not? I guess you can make your choice. And the other one is two meals a day. And again, there are two passages, one from Spiritual Gifts 153, where she says, I have lived for 8 months upon two meals a day. So she has apparently done well on this. You go on and read the rest of it, she's feeling better than she ever has, kind of thing. Then many eat three times a day, and again just before going to bed. That sounds like four times a day, right? In a short time, the digestive organs are worn out, for they have no time to rest. These become miserable dyspeptics. Presumably these people become miserable dyspeptics and wonder what has made them so. The cause has brought the sure result. A second meal should never be eaten until the stomach has had time to rest from the labor of digesting the preceding meal. If a third meal be eaten at all, it should be light and several hours before going to bed. Now that sounds like, well, three meals a day is okay as long as you don't make the last one heavy and you eat it before going to bed. You know, that's almost verified, depending on who's doing the grading. So, you know, the two that are not verified are pretty shaky examples of a mistake. Now, an example of an unverified why will give you an idea as to why these things are a little bit tougher to defend. Ministry of Healing, page 276. Notice this is quite a ways past her original vision. Scrupulous cleanliness is essential to both physical and mental health. Impurities are constantly thrown out from the body through the skin. Its millions of pores are quickly clogged unless kept clean by frequent bathing, and the impurities which should pass off through the skin become an additional burden to the other eliminating organs. Skip a paragraph there. It is important also that the clothing be kept clean. The garments worn absorb the waste matter that passes off through the pores. And if they're not frequently changed and washed, the impurities will be reabsorbed. Maybe there is some microscopic stuff that's going on there, but it certainly isn't major. And lest we're thinking that we're judging her too harshly, she's actually following the advice of the day in that particular thing. At the time, Sylvester Graham believed that the skin is the main excretory organ of the body and the kidneys are only a backup to the skin. In fact, he recommended that you run around without clothes, period, because that way your pores wouldn't get clogged and you'd be able to excrete all that stuff. Somehow that recommendation didn't catch on. And Alcott and Coles agreed, although they didn't go as far as to say you shouldn't wear clothes. And Jackson, in The Law of Life, These are all health reformers. Page 151, the skin takes at least 3/5, he's talking about excretion, the lungs and kidneys another 1/5, and the bowels the remaining 1/5. So this is the thought, that it's not just the little tiny microscopic things that are coming out of the skin, it's that massive waste is coming out of the skin. Now, don't get me wrong. I'm quite happy that everybody here is bathing. But it has more to do with the smell than it has to do with that you're going to ruin your excretory organs. By the way, Graham may have died because of his belief, because he thought that the kidneys weren't all that important, and therefore drinking fluid wasn't that important. You could get all the water you needed from your food. And there's some suggestion that he may have died from not getting enough fluid. He died early, at age 57 or so. Now, we're going to discuss how this fits in with inspiration. If we assume that inspiration is always 100% accurate, which is kind of a standard assumption, that if it's really inspired, God's not going to inspire wrong ideas, right? Well, the what's could be inspired, because you only have two what's in the spiritual gift stuff, where she explicitly says this is the result of my vision. But the whys, it's really hard to argue that the whys are inspired. That is, Ellen White's concept of physiology was roughly in tune with the ideas of her time. And what you have to remember is that the ideas of her time, we're talking 1863, this is before Koch made his postulates about disease, cholera, plague, tuberculosis. People thought scrofula came from pigs. As it turns out, most of it comes from cow's milk. And careful pasteurization plus getting rid of cows that have tuberculosis has made milk much less likely to give you scrofula. And so it is rather amazing. I mean, she fit into her time quite well, and we're going to see that in some statistics in just a minute. But I think one can argue that Ellen White was told what to do and left to figure out why, or that God adapted his reasoning to the knowledge of the times. That in an area before you know that germs cause disease, he just says, don't do that. And then she has to figure out, and sometimes doesn't. In the case of salt, she says, I don't know why. Now, I'm comfortable with this because when I wrote my book, Scientific Theology, the main chapter, which is chapter 3, a lot of people think the main chapter is 5. 5 was thrown in because it needed to be there for people who were scientific, who were reading the book. But the main chapter, which is chapter 3, was concerned with how authoritative a reputedly inspired source should be. That is, how much do you trust it? And that's a two-edged sword, because if you trust it and it turns out to be wrong, then you shouldn't have trusted it to begin with. So, as I would say in science in general, falsifiability and the ability to make predictions go hand in hand. Prediction is the way of saying, if all the circumstances are true, then A should happen instead of B, C, D, or E. And of course, any theory that does that sticks its neck out, because if B happens instead of A, then the theory is wrong. And in that chapter, I argued that the main point of a vision needs to be correct. And you could call this, if you wanted to, limited inerrancy. The main point of a vision has to be correct. That part, if the main part of a vision is incorrect, then the vision is no good, and other visions by the same person probably fail too. So you do have, in a sense, an inerrancy. But it's not the standard inerrancy, because secondary points should be, in general, as correct as possible, but errors here do not directly discredit the revelation. As long as it's correct in the main point, the secondary points are not critical, although it's nice to have them. And I think we should have respect for the secondary points, but not a belief in inerrancy. And by respect, I mean the same kind of thing that you would, the way you would treat a scientific textbook. Let's say you're in medicine, and let's say you want to know, should I be using a particular medicine to treat a particular disease, or should I be using a particular procedure? If I read in the book, this is the way you should do it, the guy knows more than me. In general, I'm going to believe it. It doesn't mean that I will say this is going to be true for all time. Sometimes we're wrong. But it does mean it's our best information right now. On the other hand, if somebody does a whole bunch of studies and they're properly done, properly controlled, and so forth, and it starts saying that really we should do something else, then the textbook can't stand against that. So there is a sense in which the textbook is not the final authority, but it's still a respected one. And I think that when you're talking about secondary points, you know, Ellen White has information I didn't. So you have to be very respectful, and you have to be very careful not to contradict unless the evidence is overwhelming. This is particularly interesting because, you see, in the what's, in spiritual gifts, 70% of the what's are significant. That is, they make a huge difference in lifestyle. 30% are probably, you know, they're true, but there's good evidence for them, but it's not like it makes a life or death difference. Okay? And there's that two of them that we mentioned that Dr. McMahon, anyway, felt he couldn't verify from the literature. Maybe they're true, maybe they're not, but you couldn't say. Interestingly, in Ministry of Healing, you get quite a few of the post-spiritual gift stuff. So it looks like she may have picked up some information from her surroundings. So it looks like spiritual gifts, which is the earlier one, the one where she knew less and the one where she relied the most on the visions, is in fact more accurate, which is the opposite of what you'd expect if she was gradually learning this stuff. And that to me is interesting. It says that the visions are more reliable than Ellen White in general. Now, of interest, the whys are horrible. In the Ministry of Healing, 45% of them can be verified. Now, there's probably a small proportion that just hasn't been verified yet, but that maybe with more study we'll find out. But I think that there's probably at least a portion of these that are not going to fit, regardless of how well you try to squeeze them in. Skin being a major excretory organ and being one of them. And the post-spiritual gifts is a little better, which is the exact reverse trend. It looks like Ellen White is learning more about the whys as time goes on. Now, put Ellen White in her time, and you will see that the Ministry of Healing, which is the later document, not the best one, is actually Spiritual Gifts, although it doesn't have as much information. You'll notice that, Graham is 42%, Alcott is 35, Cole's 40, Jackson 42. It looks like, people are hitting, random there. Ministry of Healing is hitting 87%. Pretty amazing. This is not what you would expect from somebody who's just these are physicians. Some of them are trained, whereas on the whys, you can see that it is nowhere near as striking. These are whys of things that have been verified. So these are, we're explaining true whats. And you'll notice that Graham is 30%, Alcott is 35%, Coles is 40%, Jackson is nudging up there close to 50%. Ellen White is maybe a little better. And Kellogg doesn't quite get to Ellen White's level. But this is 50%. That's nowhere near 100%. And again, it's actually going to expand a little bit as we find out that they did in fact know what they're doing. Maybe it'll shrink as we find out that we don't know what we're doing either. But it doesn't look like it's coming anywhere near 100%. Ellen White in this looks like a fairly intelligent child of her times. Now, can you account for all of this by chance? Well, let's look at how people selected the information that went before them. Ellen White is, in fact, 11.7 standard deviations off when it comes to significant. That's a huge number, a very small p-value. 1.6, which is probably one-sided significance, that's about 10%. 10.2 in the negative direction for taking in false ideas of other people. So she doesn't adopt much from anybody else that's false. Most of what she adopts is in fact true. McMahon's book gives the chances of that happening by chance as 1.3 times 10 to the 30th. I think that's probably a slight exaggeration. But even if it's like say 10 to the 20th, it's still, the kind of thing that that statistics people would just drool over. The accuracy of Ellen White is still highly statistically significantly different from random accuracy. And that makes it really difficult to use chance as a good explanation for Ellen White's accuracy on what's, although it may explain her accuracy on whys. And let me give you a little comparison. Well, here's the most random one I could find, which is to say, this is Kellogg's use of Ellen White. And you'll notice that he's well within the 95% confidence limits. The chances of this happening are, by random chance, are pretty close to one. In fact, if anything, he's picking out more of the he's leaving out more of the significant ones and taking a little more of the unverified ones. So if anything, he's picking the worst of Ellen White. Here's the best one other than Ellen White, which is, I think this is like 5 standard deviations. This is like -3, 2.5 or something like that. So this is statistically significant. This is Jackson's use of all of the people that came before him. So, he's doing a pretty good job Here's what Ellen White looks like. She's out 11 standard deviations, down 10 standard deviations. She is taking 85% of all the significant things that anybody else said before her. And she is only taking less than 5% of the stuff that hasn't been proved yet. And this is based on ministry of healing, not spiritual gifts. So this is huge. This is not chance. Well, I've heard a suggestion that maybe she was just a brilliant person, that, and because there was no other way to say what she needed to say, she said she saw it in vision. Maybe even convinced herself that it was a vision. Well, there's some problems with that. Number one, whatever brilliance she had to be offset by the fact that she had almost no formal training. Third grade education, that was it. Number two, she may have been an intelligent woman, but in order to use intelligence, you have to have data. She would have to have been an extremely keen observer in order to get data to make her pronouncements. She didn't do any studies, at least none that we know of. You know, the closest she did to studies is, I tried this and it worked. Which is not exactly what you would call a scientific study. Her advancements seem to coincide with her visions and not with her personal experience. She gets a vision, she tries it out, and she says, yeah, it does work, rather than trying it out and then getting the vision, which is what you'd expect if she was just a very brilliant woman who was very observant and was doing epidemiology far beyond her time. Her relatively poor understanding of the why seems to exclude a brilliant theoretical mind. Now, I think she's a plenty sharp woman, but I don't think that it was her intellect that was doing this. Because if it was, then she should have been able to discover that there is something in the air that we don't understand that comes from, you know, and then you would expect her to jump on the germ theory as soon as it's presented and use it as the rationale for doing some of this stuff. And at least in the case of salt, and certainly in the case of some other stuff, she claimed not to understand why her advice was sound. So if this is a brilliant woman, she had to be doing this by experimental epidemiology, not by theoretical brilliance. And finally, I have no record of her conducting research other than after the visions, she's trying it and saying, oh, boy, I feel so much better. Which again is, I guess it's, you know, it's N equals one research and it's valuable, but it's certainly not the kind of thing that would allow you to make 96% correct predictions and maybe 100%. And finally, I would say, if she really was that brilliant, it would be worthwhile taking her advice for that reason alone. That is, if you write her off as just a brilliant woman who didn't really have visions, she's sure brilliant. And it's sure worth following her advice. Now, here's where it gets interesting. Is Ellen White's inspiration any different from the inspiration of the Bible writers? Maybe in degree, in kind, it's really hard to make a good theological difference. Let's just for fun take this model and push it into the biblical realm. The Bible seems to be unconcerned with mechanism. And the best text I can give you that, and as Jesus passed by, he saw a man which was blind from his birth, and his disciples asked him, saying, Master, who did sin, this man or his parents, that he was born blind? And Jesus answered, neither this man had sinned nor his parents, but that the works of God should be made manifest in him. Now I want you to notice something about that text. Jesus didn't say, neither this man nor his parents, but it was really his grandparents, or it was really the people down the road who injured his mother while he was in utero, or, you know, somebody else sinned, or perhaps there's some illness that causes blindness from birth. He said, I don't really care who sinned. He said, we're not even going to go into that question. He said, the point is, he's blind, and the works of God are going to be manifested in him, which is an entirely different question from what the disciples were asking. The disciples were asking, if you like, a scientific question. Jesus is asking a curative question. It's the difference between the biologist who tries to figure out why somebody's blind and the physician who wants to cure it. With the one exception that Jesus seems to be able to cure without having at least overtly figured out what the problem was. You remember Galileo. Galileo quoted Caesar Baronius that the Bible teaches us how to go to heaven, not how the heavens go. Most of us have come down on the side of Galileo in that particular dispute. This offers us a justification as to why. From this kind of theology, one expects the Bible not to tell us how the heavens go, because the Bible's not really that concerned about mechanism. It's more concerned about history and about what to do. In this view, without having to further twist anything, if there are episodes of reported demon possession that sure sound like epilepsy to us, they may have been epilepsy rather than demon possession. We have people who match the story of the man, the boy who kept throwing himself into the fire and into the water. We give them Dilantin. I'm not aware that Dilantin gets rid of demons. Are we doing the wrong thing? Should we be exercising instead? Maybe not. There may be some cultures in which demon possession is more common, and I'm not ruling that out. But I'm saying that in Western society, when we see something that sounds like the biblical record but that looks like epilepsy, and we give them phenobarbital, Dilantin, or one of the other anti-Keppra, let's say, and they get better, that's not exercising demons in the strict sense. There is actually a physical mechanism for that, not a demonic mechanism. Now note that Jesus' cure would still be a miracle, because nobody else could fix this boy, including his disciples who tried. But what it means is we are not stuck trying to defend, well, it really was demon possession, even though it sounded a lot like epilepsy. We can say, could have been epilepsy. Jesus really didn't care. He was more into fixing people than to figuring out exactly what had gone wrong. And you remember the story of Jacob, where he had tried to do some prenatal influence in order to get more cattle that had various kinds of marks. So when the ewes were at the feeding trough and the rams were likely to jump on them at that point, he would put something up in front of them to try to influence the kids to be ring straight. The kids are literal now. Ring straight or speckled or spotted or whatever his portion at that time. And God showed him in a vision, no, you don't understand. The rams that jump on, they look white, But really inside they're string-straked and they're speckled and they're spotted. It's as close to getting into saying, you know, all of that stuff you were doing, that was hocus pocus. This is the real thing. I'm making sure that the genetics are working out the way they should. Your pitiful little poplar saplings or whatever you were putting in front of them that had the little marks on them, you weren't really doing anything. I was doing that. I'm taking care of you. You need to trust me rather than trying to manipulate things. And so God made that explanation. Well, technically, he should have said that the rams could bear it too, right? Well, or the ewes could have those same genes too. Well, you know, he told Jacob what he could absorb. Now, this cuts both ways. Any doctrine that says that, well, it doesn't necessarily have to be perfect. Also, especially in the terms of mechanism, also means that we better be careful about using the Bible to try to establish mechanisms. I think we can read the Bible for scientific hints. It's worthwhile checking out. But I don't think that we should read the Bible for scientific absolutes, particularly mechanistic scientific absolutes. Now, at this point, somebody's going to say, wait a minute, what about the miracles? What about creation? Well, the first thing I'm going to say is the practical advice, once you've looked at the context and you've decided that the context is applicable today as well, we're stuck with it. And that means that the Ten Commandments are still valuable. But perhaps theology should be built up slowly, and pronouncements have to be taken with, they have to be looked at as using models. The models themselves could fall apart. And for example, if there's a ransom model that Jesus gave his life as a ransom, that's a model and it probably has some truth in it. But we need to be careful about extrapolating that to an absolute model that covers all of contingencies. That in some senses, all of our theological pronouncements are like parables. And you can't make a parable walk on all fours. Now, history should be more reliable. That is to say, people can see what's happening even if they don't understand exactly why. And I would point out that this doesn't mean that we can ignore creation or the flood, because creation and the flood, in fact, are not science. They're history. In fact, to be precise, the most important parts of them are definitely not science. They're outside of science. None of us experimentally has any clue as to how to make a fish or a lizard or a cow. We don't even know how to make other people. We do know how to procreate, but that's a little different. And so there's no science to it at all, that part of it. Now, there might be science to saying that God designed things and therefore you could expect certain things to happen from them, but you don't have a science of how God did it. And those who are insisting that we need a science before we can accept are basically saying that all of history belongs to science, and they're wrong. The Ten Commandments are practical advice and therefore need to be very carefully kept. Wherever the conditions that are listed in the Ten Commandments are there, we have the obligation to keep them. I would go so far as to say that wherever the conditions are, that the laws of Moses in general fit, then we should keep them. Because they're a good idea. And that is why, among other things, the Adventist Church believes that the distinction between clean and unclean meats is still a valid one. Because in important ways, it still fits. And I would go on to say that the resurrection is history and not science. Nobody here knows how to resurrect a body. Nobody in the world knows how to resurrect a body. I teach how to get the body going back if it hasn't been too long, but believe me, if they've been dead a day, I can't do a thing. I think the same standard can be used on other reputed authorities. That is to say, for example, the Quran can be looked at this way. Look at the central point in every revelation. If it fits, fine. If it doesn't fit, if all the early ones fit and all the later ones start to have an obvious bias, maybe Muhammad turned bad somewhere in there. I don't know. Somebody needs to go through that and look carefully. It's possible that God started out using Muhammad and then he kind of drifted a little. I think the same is true of the Book of Mormon. But for example, let's say washing hands, using only one hand instead of another. Well, you know, in modern society, we wash our hands, so it's not a problem. But if you're in a society that's in the desert, it's kind of nice to keep the unclean hand doing the unclean stuff and the clean hand doing the clean stuff. You're less likely to get sick. It actually makes sense. And there are a lot of things in the Quran that are that way. They do make sense. The same thing is true of the Book of Mormon. This is how you look at things. What is the main point of the vision? Does it fit? I think at least the Book of Abraham, Joseph Smith's authority starts to collapse, but that's my opinion. The works of Zoroaster, as a matter of fact, I think if you try to get back to the original works, from what I have been told, and I haven't had a chance to check this out in thorough detail because it's hard to get back to who did what, it looks like his presentation is one that allows for the good God and the bad God to be fighting each other, and in the end, the good God wins. That's a great controversy. And in fact, if you're going to represent God, you represent him by fire. Why? Because fire doesn't have a form. It doesn't have a body. Do I remember something about a bush that didn't burn up? About the Shekinah, which was actually God's presence, but wasn't a statue, wasn't an idol? I think God reaches into all kinds of cultures and gives them some truth. I think the Tao may have been left over from the flood. And that the general principles may, in fact, be true. If I can put it this way, I believe there is only one morality that is seen more or less clearly by different groups. That just as God is made of one flesh, all nations of earth, that he has also given, he has given one message to all. And some listen better, some distort it more. And before you say, well, Christians have it right, most Adventists would say that in the Middle Ages, Christians had their own problems with distorting the message. maybe Adventists even distorted just a little bit. We have the concept of present truth, which means we're going to go beyond this eventually. And I would say that the same thing is true for personal experience, that there comes a point in your life where you hear this voice talking to you, or you get this impression saying you should go over to so-and-so's place. You know the stories. You go over to so-and-so's place and you find out that they're getting ready to be evicted for something, and you happen to have money that will cover and allow them not to be. That you walk in when there's a fight. I don't know. There's all kinds of stories that will say that when you went there, you realized that was the voice of God telling you. How do you know it's the voice of God? You don't. But as you get more experience, either obeying or disobeying that voice, I think you do get an idea eventually as to whether that's really the voice of God. And I think that's the experience that people like Abraham had. He heard a voice. He didn't know who it was. It identified himself as God, but you know, it could have been something else. Occasionally people hear voices and they're just insane. How does Abraham know? Because when he follows it, the results happen that impress him that, yes, indeed, this really is God's voice. And you keep doing that enough, and you get to the ironclad conclusion that when I hear that voice, I had better obey. Because he's right. And that's the kind of faith that will take Abraham and say, you know, I don't know how it's going to work out. Isaac is the promised one. But if God says, take him up to the mountain, I better do it. Now, when using this theory, I want you to, if you adopt this kind of thing, I don't want you to adopt it because I said so. Well, because I made a wonderful presentation and all the facts fit in. That's nice. But what I want you to really do is to say, it's founded on these presuppositions. You challenge the presuppositions, the theory is no longer valid. It may still be true, but it no longer follows from the logic. And I think that's true of any theory that you're using. I use the term theory in theology because I think that our theological propositions are in fact theories with different kinds of support behind them. And I think that's one thing that we should do with theology in general, is to use that kind of evidence-based theology, if you like. Most of us do that kind of unconsciously when we use biblical stories to back up our theological ideas. I'm just asking us to do it consciously, is all. But that's my opinion. Now it's your turn.
I saw an interesting demonstration talking about the skin absorbing things that you can take a glass of water, see how much chlorine is it with those little things, mm-hmm. and then you put your hand in there and leave your hand in there for a couple minutes. You take your hand out, you drop some of those little things in, and the chlorine has absorbed into your hand and the skin, and it doesn't show up in the water anymore. Kind of interesting little thing, showing absorptions.
That's an experiment that I haven't seen done. I would expect the opposite to happen because we sweat all the time. I am though frankly concerned, because I do know that if you measure how much comes out of the kidneys, it's way more than comes out of the skin. And the fact of the matter is, if people don't bathe, they don't get chlorine poisoning. You know, I guess, you know, the point I'm making is, I think, I've seen people do this kind of thing, you know, put sugar in the stomach and try to see how much alcohol comes out of it. It failed. And the person was horribly discouraged. And I think that if it had been more of a, well, let's see if it actually works, and then if it works, fine, and if it doesn't work, I'm not going to sweat too much. But realizing that the whats are what God really is interested in, and the whys are used, I don't know whether God, by God or by the prophet, to try to explain why you should do the whats that God has recommended. You know. And I think that that's, I think what we're doing is when we try to use the whys in a wooden manner, is we are setting ourselves up for people throwing the whole thing out. Whereas the whats are now demonstrated very clearly in the fact that Adventists are one of the five groups in the world that has the most centenarians. And if you read the literature, you'll find out it is Adventist, it's not Loma Linda. One of their examples was a lady in Arizona who was 112 years old. I think she's since died, but still, you know, 112 is pretty good. You know, she was living with her 80-something-year-old daughter. I mean, it's it was just amazing. And you see, those kinds of things, you get this odd mix of Ellen White said crazy stuff, and if you pick out the right crazy stuff, you can make it sound pretty crazy too. Although, to be fair, if you go back to the people that she was dealing with, it wasn't crazy then. It actually fit. But the whats are incredibly good. And the whats that can be demonstrated not to have come from other people, or be presumed not to have come from other people, are so close to perfect that it makes you wonder if the gold standard isn't off rather than Ellen White.
I would just make two comments here. First one, speaking of inerrancy, I think this is an ideal that can realistically not be reached, at least certainly not verbal inerrancy. Words change meaning. In the South, evening used to be after what we call afternoon. Depends on the culture you're in. Words are not absolutes. They change their meaning. And there are many other examples of this. When I was a child, gay was meant something entirely different than when I got a little older, and so on. So there is that aspect of it. The other aspect is you can, if you go too far in this idea of we don't know. Well, you can say, for instance, that creation is not science. I agree. I follow what you're saying. But I would also say, how do you know God did not use science in doing creation that we don't know?
We don't.
Concern I have is that if you go too far in that direction, you're tempted to go into agnosticism and ignore reality. And to me, at least, truth ought to make more sense than error. The complications we find in truth are reality. The more we learn, the more we realize how little we know and how complicated reality is. I would say we should not give up on the search for truth just because it's more complicated. And we should, to me at least, rationally, this is the best I can do in my search for truth, is to look at this and analyze things as much as possible. Which I see a little danger of going into agnosticism if we just, prophets, they know what, but they don't know why. Which is, I think you're probably right, to a certain extent, but I don't think that should be a mantra. To say, how do we know what is what and what is why, and so on. Look at the total picture, you suggested. I agree with that 100%.
Several quick questions. Was Ellen White ahead of her time when she talked about millions of pores in her skin?
Was she ahead of her times what?
When she talked about millions of pores in our skin?
She was with her times there, because there are, in fact, sweat glands.
Yeah, but did the other people know about it?
The other people knew about it. And the other people were saying that this is a major excretory. And, if you're sweating, it is major excretory. I mean,
sure.
You've got sweat coming out. The problem that we have is that what comes out of the skin does not appear to have a lot of the waste products that need to come out. Most of them come out of the kidney instead.
Sure. But she also talked about being reabsorbed. Today we know that. When you ordered the fentanyl patch and you ordered the nitroglycerin patch, it's absorbed.
Oh, yeah.
Absolutely. So was she out of touch when she talked about get rid of, wash yourselves, bathe yourselves frequently, and you're going to be clean? I think she was making sense when she said that. Being clean and washing ourselves and taking a bath.
Again,
in the colons, for example, in the colon, when someone is constipated, water is reabsorbed and maybe some toxins are also reabsorbed. You don't want to stay there for too long.
Yeah. One can certainly, let's put it this way. I think that a lot of the mechanisms that she used are the mechanisms that were believed at her time. And if you push hard enough, you can kind of make it to where they kind of work most of the time. The one that I mentioned about the stomach and fermenting sugar, in fact, failed because the amount of alcohol that was gotten into the system was virtually zero.
This was someone else's though, right? Not.
Well, this is somebody else's experiment.
Right.
It was based on her, which I applaud, by the way. I think that these things should be put to the test. See if they come out. But I guess the thing of it is, if I don't find that the whys are exactly what I expected, I don't think that we should immediately throw over inspiration.
Right.
See, and that's the thing I'm trying to say, is be cautious about the whys, be cautious either taking them for full advice if it doesn't seem to fit everything, and be cautious about setting her up as this is a test of faith that you have to believe the why, you see, because I think you're setting yourself up for failure. But Do I recommend that people take a lot of sugar into the stomach and let it sit for a while? No. There are probably other reasons that, you know, are more physiologic, at least from what we know now, or what we think we know now anyway, than there were, than the explanation that she has in her day. But it doesn't change what she should do. And that's the key. And see, this is the thing, when people realize that it's what she recommends that is really important, then you can have a community that does what she recommends and lives longer than anybody else.
Sure. Well, if people ate 2 meals a day, I think you'd see much lesser patients in your ER.
You might. Yes. You might. I mean, that's one of the problems we have right now is obesity, and certainly a 2 meal a day regimen. Like I said, this is one area where I wonder whether maybe she has it right and we are the ones that need to catch up with her.
Absolutely. I just wanted to ask you about demon possession. I think there's a subculture even in this country that even now people are dealing with satanic powers that we as Adventists really don't know of. And yes, when you study the Bible, the Gospels, you hear about demon possession all the time.
Well, let me put it this way.
Maybe not.
I have a next-door neighbor who was a missionary to Singapore.
Yes.
For years. And while he was there, he came back absolutely convinced that there was such a thing as demon possession.
Well, I have to tell you.
Because he'd seen stuff.
Right.
That is really hard to explain on standard medical terms.
Right. Impossible. And for a girl in the college, I went to Philippines in college in the 70s, changing her voice to a man's voice as deep as can be, and her strength, not 10 people could hold her back, and a prayer, she's calm as can be. I mean, you see these things. Of course, deal with seizures. You know, this ain't no seizures.
Yeah.
No, so demon possession is there, and in this country, even today, there are places that are dealing with demon powers.
Yeah. But what I am saying is that, you know, if the evidence does seem to fit a more standard model, I don't think that we should say, well, then all demon possession is bunkum, and we can just toss it overboard. That's the point I'm making. Is that the proving that one case makes more sense in a more modern, you have somebody with seizures and sure enough you do CAT scan, they have a meningioma. Well, that's not the devil there, you know. On the other hand, I think there are cases of flat out demon possession, and there may be cases that are mixed. Right now, here, and I don't understand quite why, demon possession seems to be much less common. The flat-out demon possession of the kind you're describing, where the you know the voice changes and the person has strength that you can't believe, and you know, and seems to know stuff that they have no business knowing, you know. That kind of stuff is pretty rare in the United States. At least rare in the areas where I frequent. That doesn't mean it doesn't happen. It doesn't mean it doesn't happen overseas much more frequently. And it doesn't mean it didn't happen in biblical times. But you can see that there might be a case of mistaken diagnosis. And Jesus seems to just not care about that. You know? And I think that in a certain sense, we should also kind of not care about that either. If we can make it go away, wonderful. And, you know, the only real question is dilantin better, or is praying in the name of Jesus better, or should we do both? And maybe the answer is we should do more of both most of the time. I don't know. But I do know that the traditional diseases happen in India too. You know, people do get brain tumors and have seizures from them.
Yes. Yeah. I have seen demon possession in Haiti, which is impossible to explain, I'd say by, I shouldn't say impossible, but a seizure per se, super strength, speaking foreign languages. This is weird. I think you're right.
This is a person whose exposure to foreign languages has been extremely limited.
Yeah. You're correct. It doesn't seem to happen very often here in the United States.
Maybe there are rules that keep demon possession out here right now.
I do not understand that. I can tell you that I felt privileged to have seen this when I was facing rather serious challenges to my faith at the University of Michigan and so on. I realized, hey, this is a reality here that is being ignored. But getting back to the main theme here, I would say in favor of giving priority to the what and not the whys is the fact that our understanding of the whys and so on is often tainted by our complete misunderstanding of what's most important. The disciples, you know, repeatedly, you know, they were going to make Christ the king. They were going to make him. They did not understand his mission.
John the Baptist didn't understand his mission.
Our estimate at present now of success is wrong. You know, popularity and are regarded as and so on. This is, you know, what we consider success. Christ says, no, it's how good a servant you are that's success. Entirely different. So we need to pay attention to those to the whats very much so, and not so much to the whys, because we don't understand sometimes the whys at all.
Yeah. Now, I will say that the whys are about half right, judging from our imperfect standard. And we may find out that some other ones turn out to be better than we thought. We may find out that on the skin there's a whole bunch of stuff that we didn't know about. That could happen. What I want to do is to have people not fighting that constantly in their lives. So, boy, if we don't find it, we're just going to have to give up. No. You know? You don't give up because of one error. And see, this is the thing, this is the reason why I want to be careful really about inerrancy, is because what inerrancy does is it builds a really fragile glass structure. One little tick in one little area and the whole thing comes down. And I'd prefer something more analogous to wood, where you can pound holes into it and it doesn't break. It bends a little and keeps right on going. Or maybe like metal that, you know, if it deforms a little bit, nothing happens. But the idea is that where you have a structure where the entire thing is held together, you know, one little fragile knock in it and the whole thing falls apart. Interestingly enough, I have a book that actually defends inerrancy. And you find out that the way they deal with inerrancy turns out to be what we're doing anyway. And so I think that we're better off being upfront and saying, you know, some things we can allow errors, some things we can't. Rather than trying to say, well, we don't believe in errors. Well, what about this? Well, you see, you have to understand it the way they understood it. Well, by the time you do that, hey, you know, why don't you just say, you know, it doesn't fit with what we believe. We think we're better, and maybe we are, and so what? We have a comment in the back here.
I like to think of this in the big context. When I stand before God, I am in awe of His divinity. And there can be a problem with that when it's carried in extreme. But part of accepting His divinity and His humanity, they have different sides, but part of accepting that is believing what He says. It's when I was a child, my parents told me things, and being who I am, I questioned everything. We were not adversarial about that. We were together questioning everything. I being more contrarian than either of my parents, and my son being much more than any of us, in a wonderful way, actually. And I just can't possibly understand why everything. I'm so thrilled when I figure out why. But I hate to say it in such a simplistic manner, but I just feel like it's not very intelligent. In fact, it's just stupid and dangerous. It makes so much trouble to not just do what God says. Because if He's who He says He is, and He is good, what He's told us is for our own good. And so I'm coming at this from a different angle than logic. I'm coming at it from the values angle. And my value says, that I put my belief on, is that God is correct. He does not play games. He's not misleading me. I trust in that. And many of these things that I don't understand, that I'm glad to look at scientifically and expect to as a responsible person, and believe that God welcomes me to look at, and that He's not afraid to have us look. He doesn't have things He has to hide. When I understand just how God basically is and how He relates to us, the integrity of Him, and also my limitations, I think it's appalling to think that I'm going to understand everything. And I do have respect for the gentleman who refused to have anything to do with the gift of inspiration. I can't imagine, I mean, if God asked me to do that, I don't know what I would do. I'm so grateful I wasn't asked. Because our human limits, we can put those on other people. Instead of just sorting through and saying, well, I don't understand this, I don't understand that, but I sure respect the person who said it, I'm just going to do it. And I've got plenty of time to figure out why. And the prophet who spoke was a human, I'm sorry. God used whatever He did. At one time He used Balaam, which I still don't get.
At one time He used Balaam's donkey, which...
Well, that gives me encouragement right there. Because, you know, I sure would not have picked Balaam if I were God. Didn't He have somebody better? So, at one time, I did research. Just library research for Dr. Betty Sterling. This was years ago. I was at Harvard. I went into Radcliffe, and the archives, amazing research, original fragile documents, hunting for information of women in religion. I was studying Ellen White's milieu in its social context, just collecting materials for Dr. Betty to write a book that she wrote. And I was astounded at the integrity, how straightforward and clean Ellen White was compared to anyone else of all the prophetic people going on at that time. I even ended up in nuns' diaries and said, okay, that's, you know, I don't have any more original materials I want to look through that are found in New England area archives, okay? And looking at her human life, what a trustworthy person compared to every other woman who was involved in religion that I could, and I studied a lot. You know, I pulled all of them in the length of time I could do in a summer. So, you know, God takes a risk using us. You can see where I'm coming from. Looking at the great controversy perspective, he takes a risk. And the least I can do is to carefully, respectfully hunt through and do what is said, because it's going to turn out better if I do.
God turn around. Used a big fish for Jonah.
God used a big fish for Jonah.
God uses all kinds of stuff. Yep. But I'm thinking about to give propositional information. You know, the donkey actually said something that was worth listening to. Big fish just took Jonah for a ride, so to speak. But you're right, Balaam was, and that's one of the reasons why I think even where we see the prophets aren't very good, I think we need to be very careful throwing stuff out. Just to give an example, I can't trust everything that Joseph Smith wrote. But Mormons are the second longest lived group in America outside of Adventists. I mean, give credit where credit's due. Obviously something stuck. And I think it's, well, you know, there are Christians who approach Muslims and just say, you got to forget everything that Muhammad said and start from the ground up. There are other Christians who have said, well, Muhammad said this and Muhammad said this, and actually build on what they have. And eventually, yes, there'll probably be places where Muhammad gets rounded off a little. But you're taking, it's an entirely different way of approaching it. And you have people who at the end believe in the divinity of Jesus and the, Muslims are going, where'd you get that? Well, just, you know, follow the trail and you'll see where they got that. But it's two different approaches. You know, one of which is a completion, and the other one of which is a complete negation. Maybe it depends on the person which is the better approach. But that implies that there are a lot of people for whom the completion approach is the better one. I think this has implications far beyond just inspiration. It's how we do theology. It's how we view theological doctrines, theories. It's how we test. It's even the relative merit we put to theological pronouncements and stories. You know, when I was first reading the Bible, the stories are interesting. They really are. But they're interrupting the real stuff, you know, the theology. And I have come to view it in a different light. I hope I've come to realize. But that's, you know, kind of prejudicial to my viewpoint. Prejudicial in favor of my viewpoint, in that the stories are actually the more accurate ones. Because they are not constructs based on other constructs that are based on other constructs that have limited engagement with the real world. These are actually the real world. These are the data that you're dealing with. And that, for example, the story of Joseph can be viewed as, you know, God takes care of his own. It can also be viewed as the story of a dysfunctional family and how God finally brought it together. And, you know, at the end, it still was still a little dysfunctional. But he kept with him anyway. You know, remember that when Jacob died, all the brothers came. Now, we've really been good. You know, don't kill us, because Daddy said don't kill us. Joseph said, forget about all that, you know. And it's just, it's a story of Judah as much as it is of Joseph. And there are all these things interwoven. And how do you do that? Well, you tell the story simply, and all those things are buried in the story itself. That's the beauty of the story, is that it's actually true on multiple levels because it's true to life. And life is true on multiple levels. And so in this very important sense, the story is more important than the theological pronouncements. And that's, of course, heresy, and that's the exact reverse of what most theologians will tell you. But I think it's arguable that if you really want to know what righteousness is, what dikaiō means, you listen to how Jesus uses it in a story rather than listening to Paul expound upon it in multiple theoretical ways. That the theory is good, I'm not degrading that, but the story is actually more fundamental evidence. And so I think that there's a whole bunch of things that fall upon this, fall out from this, that are important. And I think if we as Adventists were to adopt this kind of viewpoint in general, we would be better off. But again, that's my opinion.
Can we say that the what is fact and the why is less objective, and still feel that we're approaching truth? I'm coming back to a scientific.
Yes. Well, you know, in science, there's a delicate interplay between evidence and theory.
Yeah.
And there's very little theory that doesn't have some evidence behind it, and there's very little evidence that doesn't have some theory
to it. It's not a clean
what
line.
The evidence is. It's not a complete cut and dried separation. But on the whole, the evidence is primary. And that's one of the things we learned from the Middle Ages.
I feel more secure in that mode. And
that means that the creation story is evidence.
Well, sure. I mean, that mode forces me into saying there's a designer. I just walk right into it. I mean, I can't.
Yeah.
Can't get out around it.
And that also means the resurrection is evidence. It has all kinds of theological implications. But the root thing is that a man walked out of the grave after being in there for well over 24 hours.
Yeah.
That's the root. After having been crucified and stabbed in the chest just to be sure he was really dead.
The reason why Mormons are so healthy is because what the Seventh-day Adventists did to help them. Yes.
They adopt many of the same things that we've adopted.
Sure. Well, Dr. Kellogg was invited and he spoke to 700 Mormons in Salt Lake City.
Dr. Who?
Dr. Kellogg himself.
Oh.
Yes. And he was invited by the president of Mormon Church at that time. And they adhere to that practice and they have been getting benefits of that. The reason why the Lord chose Balaam, it gives us hope that he can use us too. You know, talking about ministry among Muslims and their beliefs is so close to Seventh-day Adventists. When they find out who I am, they'll say, you're better Muslim than I am. I mean, these are educated Muslim folk.
Oh, yeah. Adventists have a huge reputation because
yes.
We don't smoke, we don't drink, we don't run around with women or men, as the case may be.
Yes. The food they eat, the our eating habits, I mean, tremendous respect they have for us. They are misogynistic Jews. They are also Muslims who believe in the deity of Christ.
Yes, I know.
Yes, there are Muslims who keep the seventh-day Sabbath holy, who will allow only the Seventh-day Adventists to go into their mosque and no other Muslims. This is for real. When you study the Quran, it's there.
Keep because the Sabbath is in the Quran.
Yes, tremendous.
That's what I'm saying. You know, you can raise everything to the ground and try to rebuild, or you can say, well, look, here's something that you can build on.
Yes.
Here's something else you can build on. Here's something else you can build on. And, you know, when you get to where the two structures start abutting each other, you say, well, maybe we need to shave a little bit off here.
Right. Well, you know, our job is really not to count our converts. I grew up an Adventist, and my dad pastor, you know, and how many did you baptize? That's not our job. Our job is to go and teach and preach. And as Adventists, as medical caregivers in places, our opportunity is absolutely boundless. Absolutely boundless. And I believe that he's going to use us quickly, and it's going to happen very fast, very quickly.
Well, I see this all building up.
Yes.
And I think that the final events will be very much like, maybe even faster than, what we saw when Eastern Europe fell from communism. You know, it's 8 weeks and it was done.
And it could be very handful of people who are going to be involved in this. It's going to happen.
God builds it up to where it needs to be, and all of a sudden, what looked like it was going to last for centuries is gone. Well, I think that's probably good for today. And maybe next week, those of you who have the chance can review Behe's Edge of Evolution. I'll try to send over some particularly pertinent links, and I think it'll be interesting to see what's happened to it.